we are able to help them finish the bridge.
Two quick things, just to kind of ease your conscience. Even though I designed the bridge and Lauren headed up the construction schedule, we had professional engineers check our work and sign off on them to say that they were happy. So the bridge is still standing, Lord, and everything ran smoothly. And the other thing I just wanted to touch on is, and you'll see the pictures that show that, actually, it might be the next one. Oh, well, let's see. I'll come back to that point. So, to talk about the impact of a pedestrian bridge, you can kind of think like, okay, you want to build a bridge because you want to save lives from people crossing the river and drowning. And that's a real thing, and people do risk their lives every day to cross to get to school or to get to their jobs. But not only are rivers holding people back during the rainy season from accessing whatever it is, it's also kind of holding them back economically and keeps them in this poverty. And so a bridge doesn't only save lives, it also increases school enrollment by 12%. It increases healthcare treatment by 24%. Local business increases by 15%, and women employed up to 18%. So there's tangible impacts just by a simple bridge, and it doesn't change one life, it changes and connects like multiple communities, which is really cool. And to me, my favorite thing by far about our organization for Just Prosperity is that we're not just a bunch of Americans flying down and building this bridge ourselves and leaving and saying, hey, we think you need a bridge, here you go. It's really collaborative. And so first off, we talk to the community beforehand and really try to understand the needs that they have as a community, and to make sure that they really want and desire a pedestrian bridge. And then, secondly, we build a bridge with them. And so that's kind of all of our stories that you're going to hear are centered around that key piece, is that it's with them and it's their bridge. And we just are the lucky ones that get to be there. So,
Yeah, I was just going to say that's something like integral to our organization, is that we never want to pronounce it as our bridge, and like you might say like, oh, this is the bridge we built, but it's really their bridge, and it's something that they want and are obviously contributing to a lot. And so the Rwandan government was extremely helpful in working with us, and they would pay workers to be on site with us so they didn't have to like lose income from their actual job, which was most likely farming for most people. So it was really important to see that people would take off their job and be paid to come help us out, because it really meant that they're like putting forth this effort and want this too.
And having them throughout the entire construction process means that they're learning how we built the bridge. So that just means that they can keep it up and make sure that it's safe for everyone for the next however many years. So they know exactly how to maintenance it, they know how to take care of it, they know how to fix it if something breaks. And that way, you know, we can leave and their whole entire bridge is still sustainable and it can still help them for years to come.
Okay, these are just some kind of pictures that I hope you can see about the critical need that they have for these bridges. So this picture was taken when we were there, and we were during the dry season, but during the rainy season, these rivers flood and people become stranded on either side, of course. And we've definitely heard some like interesting stories from people who maybe their farms are on the other side and they send their children to tend to them, and then the rivers flood and then they're stuck on either side. And another thing, as you can see, is the motorcycle. So a lot of people, that was their job. It's kind of like an Uber in Rwanda, as they would carry people on motorcycles. But when the rivers would flood, they would be stuck and couldn't do their jobs. And so that's kind of like that economic impact that Grace was touching on. And so these are just some pictures that show, you know, people carrying each other across the kind of lengths people would go to cross these rivers, even when they're flooded.
And this picture here is the really small bridge that we were using to cross while we were there. And you can see that it's pretty difficult, especially when we were the ones carrying construction materials across one little log across the bridge. Mm-hmm. So then there's these other, I mean, you'll see in a couple of later slides, women who are carrying their children across these really small bridges, especially, you know, when the rivers get really high, that's really difficult for them.
Thank you.
So just to talk about, so Bridge to Prosperity is a national organization, and Penn State has a local chapter. And so to talk kind of more locally about what we've done at Penn State, our first bridge build was in 2014, and we've built three bridges in Panama, which you'll see. So this was the first one. It was 75 meters long. Three tiers on each side is just basically how high you need it up on the ground. We designed it so that if the river floods, you know, during the rainy season, which it will, and there's a big storm and it knocks over a tree, and a tree's floating down the river, the bridge is high enough that it's not going to get smacked. And so we want to ensure that nothing is going to bring this bridge down, even a hurricane. Our second bridge was in Tucosigo, Panama. That was only 30 meters long, but it impacts 300 to 400 people daily. And we had a previous travel team go back and visit that bridge, and they said that it was so cool to see how dirty the ramp was and the walkway, and you could just tell that, like, people use this bridge, you know, like, day in and day out. And so, you know, it was just part of the local traffic, and that was really cool to see. Our third bridge was in Comitán, Panama, and that one was 54 meters long and impacted over 200 people. So we were working in Panama for a while, and then this past year we got a call from the national office, and they said, hey, do you guys think you have the money to fundraise to go to Africa? And we said, that sounds really exciting. Yeah. And we got the money together, and we got to go to Rwanda. And so 61 meters, that translates to about 200 feet. And three tiers, so it was pretty high up. So I would say it was about 30 feet in the air. And this is the crazy part. So in Latin America, the rural communities are much smaller than in at least rural Rwanda. So the bridge impacts over 800 people daily. And it was just one of the crazy things to me about Rwanda is how they use every single inch of land to the best of their ability. And so, like, these are steep hills, you know, and they're just farmland. It's all farmland, and every bit's being used. And so there's definitely a large population there.
Sure, and so to be able to go on these trips, we obviously have to fundraise a lot, so we're also like a student org on campus, and only 8 people get to travel every year, so there's definitely stuff we have to do to keep other kids engaged who aren't necessarily traveling. And so we do things like service events, so this is us at Shavers Creek, which is like a outdoor kind of environmental center at Penn State, where we were like rebuilding trails and like bridges there. And then we also have events like a surveying seminar and a construction seminar every year to help prepare the travel team. So this is a picture from our construction seminar when we try to engage like our corporate sponsors too to like make them feel like they're a part of everything. And then we also have a Fawn family and are a part of Fawn and other kinds of events on campus. So then our team travels to Rwanda, so now we're gonna kind of talk about our experiences now that we've kind of overviewed what Bridges to Prosperity is and what we do at Penn State. So this is us traveling to Rwanda.
What are you going to talk about?
Kids? Sure. Okay, so when we were in Rwanda, pretty much they had never really seen very many white people before, you know? So the very day that we got out of that van, there were so many kids that just ran over to us and were so intrigued by us and wanted to know what we were doing there. And it was kind of the cutest thing to see. So this is a picture of all the little kids, and we had an hour walk every day to our construction site. So we'd wake up in the morning, we would walk down a mountain for about an hour, 15 minutes to get to our construction site, and walk all the way back up the mountain at the end of the day. And the only thing that made that hour walk back up the mountain after a long day of work was that all of these kids would come follow us and hang out with us, and we would kick a soccer ball with them all the way back up the hill. And it was just really fun to see that they were so excited that we were there, and even with the language barrier, still we were kind of able to get to know them and like pick out who they were by the end, and they really loved seeing us. Anyone know any idea?
Yeah, I guess just to go off of that, is most of the children where we were did attend school, but some are not able to due to the like economic like feasibility of their parents and family, so they would have to like tend to the farms and wouldn't be able to go to school. But I, for the majority of them, most of them did attend school where we were at, and so it was just kind of interesting to see that there was like a school on one side, and so kids who lived on the other side of the river were, you know, kind of taking the same walk that we were every day to school and would be using this bridge, so that was definitely something important for us.
And this is kind of funny if you say it in this picture. So in Rwanda, at least where we were, there was kind of two sessions of school, so the kids would go to either the morning session or the afternoon session, and if the other time of that, you were supposed to work on the farm. But in the last like 10 days of our bridge build, it was getting really exciting because we finally had the cable hoisted up and we were building the decking and we were like up in the air doing all this stuff. And there was this like, just, I don't know, it was probably like 30 kids by the end of it that would just sit and watch.
And like,
fan club. Yeah, we had a total fan club and the parents were probably like, get back to work. But yeah, we thought it was fun, so.
And you know, they're learning a little bit of English in their schools, and the only way that they knew how to greet us was to say good morning. So it would be at night, we would be walking home, oh, good morning, and it's like 4 p.m. in the afternoon.
Good morning. Yeah. And so another kind of crucial thing that we noticed in Rwanda was how integral women are to their society. So Rwanda has an extremely high amount of women in their parliament, like more so than most other countries at all. And we even got to meet the mayor of the town that we were staying in, and she was a woman, and so that was just kind of cool for us to see how important they were in the society. And we had women working with us on site every day, and women being absolute superstars, carrying kids on their back across those log bridges that we were showing before, taking things to from the farm, like entire tubs of tomatoes, like no stress at all. And so that was just kind of nice for us to see like how important they were and how we never felt like we were really discriminated against in that way either. And then these were the children that stayed at the house right next to us. So we have pictures of kind of where we stayed coming up, but we just stayed in like this little like area that maybe like volunteers or Peace Corps members would stay in, and these were our neighbors. And so it was just kind of also interesting to see how quickly children are put into kind of these like protective roles. Like this, she's probably like 5 years old watching her baby brother, sister. And so just kind of seeing how quickly children are put into these roles, and so yeah.
And going back to, you know, having women on site with us, I think as young female engineers, we don't always see the amount of women in the field that we would like, and to see all these women on site in a different country is incredible, to know that there's a lot of women out there, not in, even in the U.S., that are really working towards women in STEM fields. It's great.
Yeah, okay, so this is a picture with me and one of my favorite Rwanda women, Sylvie. So she was a Bridge Prosperity Mason. So she was on staff with the Bridge of Prosperity team in Rwanda, and she was the only woman Mason that I think they had in the whole country. And so I think there'll be some slides later to show kind of the atmosphere that we had. But I'm just gonna like go on a little story. So we get to the bridge site the first day, and they've already been working on it. So they have the excavations done out, and they've built the foundations, and so it's time to kind of carry a lot of rocks from the roadside to the bridge and start building the tiers to give it the height. And we like are pretty wide-eyed, you know, we don't know what to expect. We've been planning for this trip all semester, and we're standing in a circle, and there's all these Rwandan workers, and they don't speak English. And like if you go to a Latin American country, you can kind of speak Spanish and get by, but we didn't know any Kenya or London. I don't remember anything. And so, yeah, we're just kind of like staring. And then this was so cool. So Everest, the project engineer in Rwanda, kind of starts with a prayer for all of us. And even though we were Penn State students, it was cool to see how the church came with us. And they had that value too. And then they started singing. And they were like praise songs, but with like an African flair, you know? And so they're clapping and stomping and dancing and all singing. And we're like, this is perfect. We love to dance. And so we started clapping and dancing too. And so rumor has it that the song that they sang to us that first day was really just a welcome song that, you know, like when you're welcoming someone, you sing that song. It's not like an everyday thing. But they saw that we liked it so much that they just like started singing at the start of every day. So for 30 days, we would start with prayer and then kind of the praise songs. And we learned them by the end of it because they're pretty simple. And the energy just grew and grew and grew. And so even though, like, the longer we were there, the more tired we were, and it was just so exhausting how the work was, but the energy just kept rising. And so we had, like, 30-minute dance-offs at the start of the bridge. And then, like, I remember one day, I, like, poured all of my energy out, like, in the mosh pit, you know? And then I was like, oh, it's 7 in the morning, and I gotta do work, but I was, like, laying in the grass. I was like, I can't do it. And so my personal favorite memory of the bridge build is that Sylvie loved to sing, and she kind of led the charge on singing these songs. And I love to sing, too, and she, like, saw it in my eyes. And so towards the end, she had me start to lead some of the African songs, and that was such a treat, so. Oh, here's just all the women on site, so you can see with our hard hats and our big guns, and we're repping.
Yeah, so this is the three of us. So we were the only girls on our trip of eight. So the other five Penn State students that went with us were all guys. And we really stuck together, I think, for a lot of the trip. And this little cross beam, so the way the bridge works is there's cables that are strung across, and then these cross beams hold up all of the decking that goes between them. So we took it, the girls' job, for probably a solid week, was to nail all of these metal bars to these wooden planks so the other wooden planks could be stacked across them. And this is us with our last one, and it was probably one of the most, like, fun jobs that we had, and it really got us, like, very close as really good friends, and it was just, like, nice to have. It was a really fun day, so.
Yeah, so another big thing with the building of these bridges is that a lot of it is rock, because all of the material is, like, from local sources, so they're getting, like, local river rocks and stuff. And so we had these, like, giant truckloads of rocks that we would just be carrying, because, like, all of the foundation.
I don't think we have a picture. We did a video.
Yeah, so see all of this? This is, like, 12 feet deep, and it's all rock. And so we had to carry all of the rock from the road, which is, like, way back here, up to here to fill it with all of the rock. And so jobs like Lauren was talking about, like, nailing and painting the cross beam, was like an oasis away from carrying rock. So you just had to, like, convince everyone that you could do, like, these little jobs other than rock and then get away from carrying rock for, like, a couple hours. So it was really the best time of, and it was such a, like, a good job to get our minds off of carrying rock, because for probably, like, 2.5 weeks of the trip, all we did was carry rock, which sounds really boring. And maybe it was, but it was worth it when the final product, when this was all filled with rock. And so, yeah, we carried a lot of rock. And then I remember specifically one day, like, this entire pile is gone, and it's, like, just little rocks left, and we're like, yes, like, we've gotten all the rock. They're like, no, there's another truck coming. And then they dump another truck, and we have to carry all of that back, too. But, yeah.
But another thing that they were saying was that, a lot of our materials are from in-country, and we do that, you know, to, first of all, stimulate their economy, and second, to make it cheaper for us that we don't have to, you know, get a bunch of materials in from somewhere else. So these metal beams were actually made at one of the engineering schools in Rwanda. So that was really cool that students that were in a different part of the country were still able to have a hand in this bridge.
That was really cool. And it was a really humbling experience for me, because I'm not that strong, I'm, like, tiny. And so carrying rocks for a month, it's like, I'm not qualified for this position, you know? but the Rwandans were, and even though they were skinnier, see, the guys, like, sometimes kind of felt more skinnier than I was, they would pick up these, like, boulders, and just, like, no problem, put them on their heads, and just walk. And they always did it with a smile on their face, and so that was, yeah, just remarkable to watch, and the woman too. It was so cool to, and they were so gracious to us, you know, like, I would have, like, a pebble, you know, on my shoulder. And they'd be like, yay, good job, you know. And so, it was, even though the rock was, like, brutal, I think especially to us, they had such a positive attitude, and that encouraged us to have a positive attitude, and so it really brought us closer together. So we just want to talk a little bit to help you visualize, like, what it's even like living in a rural village in the middle of Africa. These are some photos of where we lived, and so that's when you walked in, and each door kind of had a different little thing going on. So they would cook the food over kind of a big pot with boiling water in one of the rooms, and then there was chickens in another room. Yeah, a shower in another room, which by shower we mean just a bucket that you fill with water and dump on your head. I was like really adventurous at the beginning, and that was like, it was like exciting, you know, like, wow, I'm taking a bucket shower in Rwanda. And then I remember one night, it was like 3 weeks in, maybe 4 weeks in, and I thought I saw a bat like in the corner, and I was like, I'm done, I'm ready to go home. It was, yeah, that was a lot. But and then you walk down, and that door is where we stayed, and do we have pictures of, I don't think so, but it was awesome. Most teams from Penn State that go down have to sleep on the floor in like a schoolhouse, but we had like cots, and so we had a mattress every night, which was really great.
One of my favorite stories, and I think it kind of describes the whole trip, the very first day we were there, you know, one of the reasons that the rivers flood so bad is because they have such insane rainfalls. The very first night we were there, it started pouring at probably like 2 or 3 in the morning. And I'm laying there on my bed with my mosquito net around me, and I'm looking up at the ceiling, and I'm terrified because it's an aluminum roof with this really hard rain coming down. And all of a sudden, I have drip drops just right on my forehead as I'm laying there. And you know, everyone's awake at this point, and everyone's kind of freaking out, like, oh my gosh, what did we get ourselves into? Because it was the very first night, we hadn't seen the bridge yet. Meanwhile, that was the only time it rained the entire time. So, I mean, it was one of the scariest moments, like, oh no, like, what did I get myself into? But it really, like, described everything, because, you know, those rainfalls is why we do what we do. So.
Yeah, I think it really like instilled in us, like you felt the power of water. You know, it wasn't anything close to a thunderstorm that we have here. Like the rains were coming down so hard, it was like just a faucet, but everywhere. And so you can even imagine just how quickly a river can rise.
Do you want to talk about our kitchen?
That's our kitchen. We would just all sit around at a table, or not a table, around in a circle. And eat our meals. So a typical meal for us, so in the morning we would have eggs with onions, which was sad for me, but everyone else seemed to like it. And then eventually one of the guys we went with taught them how to make French toast, which we just had eggs and bread, but it was still awesome, and we put sugar on top, and we really made the most of everything we had. And so we would eat that for lunch, or for breakfast, and then for lunch we would typically have beans, rice, pasta, what else?
Carrots,
and kind of same thing for dinner. We bought a goat and a pig at one point to get our protein in there, but it was definitely, we were definitely lacking a little bit in protein.
That's just a fun picture to show. Yeah, even Sylvie didn't really speak English very well, and so on the surface of things, it's like, okay, yeah, we're building a bridge, but there's no way that there could be a bridge that connects us with the community if we can't even speak the language, but that was very far from the truth. And even so, the guy with the red-looking skirt on, he was one of our cooks, and he couldn't speak English at all, but somehow, I don't even know how this happened, but somehow we started goofing off on that fabric that we had bought around people when they were dancing and just being silly, and it was so fun. And after living with them for a month, like, you felt that community, and it was really cool. So that's just a picture of some of the food that, so we would go to market day every Thursday and buy our food, and then the cooks would cook it for us while we were at the grave. And it's all just locally grown, and it's what you have, you know, and you kind of make the same meals or similar meals, and there's some delicacies, but it's really cool to see how, like, really, you know, you're just working with the land, and it's cool.
You never really think you can enjoy certain things, like, so much. You know, one of the best days that we had was when somebody would come home and say, we got 2 pineapples today at market day, and everyone's eyes lit up, and everyone was so excited just to have pineapple for a day, or, like, bananas were incredible, or just, like, certain little things that, you know, we didn't get all that often. When we had them, it was fantastic. You learn to appreciate the little things a little bit more.
We had one guy who had like a major sweet tooth. And so when you're carrying rocks, you're trying to pass the time, right? And so you talk a lot. And we heard from this guy about like every dessert he was missing, you know, every day. He was every single day, he'd say the same things. But we found a like bread bakery shop in the town, a few blocks over from where we were staying. And the like secret got out that they make donuts. And so about like 2 weeks into it, Chris and Ryan were the two guys who really like sweet stuff would sneak away in the morning and come back with a big bag of donuts. And we got it. And we would eat donuts every morning, and that was fun.
Okay, so this is kind of a picture of market day, and we would stand here, and the bridge site is like way down the mountain down there. And so just to like kind of relate this back to bridges, so there weren't that many markets around, so like we stayed at kind of like a local hub, like where there was a market, and people would travel like the same hike that we would every day, like probably from like an hour away to come to market day. And so just kind of the importance of these bridges, like connecting the gap between like two sides of the river and seeing like, okay, if someone is supposed to bring tomatoes and they're on the other side of the river and the river's flooded, like no one gets tomatoes that weekend. It's just kind of shows the importance of like why we do what we do and why we are so passionate about giving this access to people. And so, yeah, just. So this is a picture of us on the mountain hiking down to site, but it was so beautiful, so we can never complain about that. It was so pretty, and we would listen to music. Yeah. And here's some kind of like the amenities that we had on site. So they kind of filtering back into the local government, they would hire security guards to kind of watch the equipment while we were away. And actually, at one point, before we even got in the country, there was a, I don't know who it was, but some community members walking at night across the river, and the security guards were there, and then they fell in the river, and they actually had to jump in and save them. So it was just kind of eye-opening for us before we even got there to see that like this is something that was important and was happening every day. And so, not even every day, but just a fear that they had. And so this was kind of where we would keep our materials on site. And then the next picture is like our kitchen on site where we would come in and get our food. And silverware from these plates. Okay, so on the last Saturday of every month in Rwanda is a national day of service called Umuganda, and it's an experience. And so we were kind of like, oh, maybe we should like volunteer somewhere during this day. Well, it turns out everyone wanted to come and volunteer with us. So I don't know if you can see, but there are probably like 100 plus people on this hillside, just like taking out this hillside for the national day of service. So we had like a huge surplus of people coming to help us, which was like extremely, extremely helpful, and also kind of that big morale booster that we needed 2 weeks in. So they just came, everyone brought their like rakes and shovels and just like took out this hillside that we didn't need anymore. And it was just a really awesome experience to see. And then I think the next picture is. So we also kind of had like a big community meeting, which was really awesome. They like introduced all of us and kind of told the community what we were doing there. And it was just like a big celebration between everyone, and we had a pretty awesome dance party then too, no surprise. And yeah, we just have to kind of integrate into the community, and there's us all sitting at the Muganda Day and just kind of integrating into the community, which was something extremely important for us.
Yeah, and that was a really interesting day. So one day we got woken up by like, you know, monsoon rains, and then 2 weeks go by and all of a sudden it's like 5 a.m. and you hear these like, sounds like teenage guys running and they're singing. I'm like, what's going on? But they were waking up the whole town to wake up for this Umuganda Day of Service. And so in like with the genocide and the horrible things that happened, to see the redemption in that whole nation is just remarkable, and they all come together. And again, like there's like nothing even close to a bad attitude. You know, they're all so happy to serve and to work together. And you can just really, it was such a powerful experience to even be a part of that day of service and see like, wow, this is just a part of their life now, you know, it's giving back.
This is a picture of us. We worked every day that we were there except Sundays. So we had 4 Sundays off. This is a picture from one day we decided to go to their church. The day before, or the week before, we went to one of the markets, and the girls got skirts to wear from one of their markets, and we went to church, and it was kind of the same thing that we were seeing at site every day. It was a lot of singing and praising, and really just bringing people together in one area. And, you know, it was just really nice to see like a community of people come together to praise God in that way. And it's something that I've never seen before. So I really appreciated it.
But it was 3 hours long.
Yeah. So then one of the other things we did on one of our weekends off was we were able to go to see one of the caves that were there. So this is some of us on a cave tour. One of our masons that was with us, Theo, he spoke English. So he came with us and we did this cave tour, which was really fun. And then he took us to see his family. So his family lived a few hours away from us. So we all hopped in a van and we went to go meet his mom and his sister and his niece. So it was really cool that, you know, they welcomed us into their home with open arms. You know, she gave us bananas and corn and like was just so happy to have us there and happy to meet us and happy to know, you know, that we were there out of love and kindness. And, you know, we just loved Theo and everything that he had to share with us.
Yeah, so I think a pretty big story and like monumental moment from that time is, so we're all hiking to Theo's house and like people were seeing us like come up in the vans, and like then word started spreading around the town that like a bunch of white people were coming in the van, and no one had any idea what was happening. And so everyone starts like following us and we're like, okay, like we're going to Theo's house. And then all of a sudden his uncle and like kind of family close friend came over and they were like nervous that we were there because maybe Theo did something wrong. Like they knew that he had this job of religious prosperity and like worked with white people. And then a bunch of white people are coming to his house and they're like, oh no, they like Theo did something wrong and like kind of made them mad and now they're here. But that was not the case at all. And once they realized that that wasn't the case, it was like a pretty big celebration. And he kind of gave us this whole speech about how we were all children of God and it was important that we can all kind of work cross-culturally and bridge this gap and like overcome these barriers and work together. And it's something that's definitely missing like kind of in our culture and around the world. And so it was important for us to see that like they felt the same way about like how we just want to work together and there's no like hard feelings there.
Yeah, and he was an older gentleman, probably in his 50s or 60s, and he was looking at us and he was like, you could tell he really meant what he was saying, you know, and he was tearing up and saying about how he was just like really felt the unity that we were all one. It was crazy to see how that impacted everyone on the trip. You know, like driving back in the vans, people kept bringing it up, and it was so cool that we got to visit his family.
That's the rest of them.
Yes, that's a picture of all of us. In the back is Theo's house. So during this first few weeks, really, it's nothing glamorous. We're just moving rock, and it feels like, what am I doing? But the last week of the trip was the coolest because we finally got to start working on the decking. And so we had like harnesses on and then a safety wire that we put across and we could clip on and then you're harnessed in. And we kind of started from one side of the bridge and would put those cross beams that we built earlier a meter apart and then drill in the decking and then go to the next meter and drill in the decking. And it was really cool, like part of us wanted to, you know, we had designed the bridge and we put so much work into it and the decking's a cool part. And I think it would be a really easy temptation to just have all the college kids up there doing the exciting decking. But for the entire time, there was at least one Rwandan up there with the drill getting to do the decking. And when I was up there, I was the only white person up there. And so that was just really cool, and I think it took intentionality on our part, but that's an experience that they're always going to remember, you know, thinking, oh wow, I was strapped up there and putting up that deck in.
So. And again, it really teaches them, you know, if something goes wrong, they're able to figure out why it went wrong, because they were in the process of building it initially. So they can go back in and say, oh, like, this screws loose, let's just screw that back in, everything's fine now. And, you know, if we were up there doing that, they wouldn't have any idea how to fix it, so. It's important for us to make sure that it's completely sustainable for them.
Yeah.
So this is kind of the point where it all gets really, really exciting, all the decking's up, but then you have to tie this fencing all together, which was a really tedious process, and we thought would be like, oh, like, we just have to tie the fencing together. But it was like every couple like links we would have to tie this tire wire on, and it was like really hard on our hands, but like we're so close and we can feel the end is near. So that was like a really long day, but then afterwards we had a huge chance.
Yeah, and you know, we're in these last couple steps of doing this, and the kids that are all watching us are getting really excited because they can see that it's almost done. So you can tell more and more kids are coming and more of them are watching, and they're all like ready to run across it as soon as we finish.
And this is so interesting. So they had like a red tape in front of the both walkways because they didn't want anyone to go on the bridge before it was finished, especially kids. And we knew that the bridge inauguration, like, official celebration was in 3 days. And so my American mind was like, okay, well, we finished today, but no one's going to get to cross until the inauguration. But all these kids are, like, lined up, really wanting to cross the bridge. And I'm like, and I see Sylvie walking over. And at this point, I'm like, my hands are aching from this fencing. And so I'm just sitting on the hillside, and it, like, hasn't even clicked that we just finished what we've been working so hard on. So I'm just kind of sitting, and Lauren's sitting next to me, I'm just kind of like staring, you know, like, it's so tired. And Sylvie's walking over, and I'm like, gosh, she's going to have to tell him to all leave and come back in a few days. And like, no, not at all, of course not. She cuts the tape for these kids, you know, she's not cutting it for the mayor, for us, or for anyone else. She's cutting it for the kids because this is their future. And she starts to sing, and they start to sing. And so they start to sing one of the praise songs. It was Wanini Neza Mana, which I can't remember what it means. I wrote it down, so I know what it means somewhere in my journal. But they're all singing this, and it's Sylvie leading, and then all of these kids, and they're just like jumping and leaping across this Sebastian Bridge, and Lauren and I both just like start to cry.
Yeah.
Watching them come towards us. It was so cool. We have some videos, hopefully that'll load and we can show you. So that's the finished bridge, and sorry these photos aren't clear so you can't totally see the whole picture, but hopefully you can see what it kind of looks like, and let's see the next one. Yeah, so this was the official inauguration day, so a few days later we come back and there's all these government officials there and everyone's dressed really well, and there was probably like 200 people,
yeah,
if not
more than that. Yeah,
and there was a lot of talking that we were just kind of sitting there and like, you know, smiling and nodding. And we didn't really know what was going on. And then all of a sudden, like, it's like this official walk, you know, and so everyone stands up and starts walking. And at this point, like, as the design manager, I'm like, I designed it to handle like a pack of horses. I hope we can handle all these people. And it did. It totally helped. So they just, sang songs for a while and really gave a celebration.
These are all the workers that were with us every day, working with us, and they were all honored at that inauguration thing, you know, and they all came up and they were so excited that they were all a part of it.
Oh. And that's a picture of all of us. You can't see the bridge, but the bridge is right behind us. And in the picture are the Penn State travel teams and then the Rwandans that we got really close with. So whether that be the BTP staff that were there as the masons or the engineers, or if that was local community members that were on that Bridge Building Committee to kind of keep it up and everything, so. Oh, and then, wait, let's go back and finish. I think Joel kind of told more stories.
Oh, I guess we covered most of
them. Okay, never mind. It's like, oh, I already gave my punchline story to Sylvie. So that was our trip, and it was really I think, you know, you sign up and you interview and then you get a spot on the travel team and it's like, okay, Mom and Dad, I'm going to Africa to build a bridge, you know, and you have no idea what you're in for. And we were all definitely blown away at just like how much it impacted us. And so this year, none of us are traveling. There's 8 new Penn State students and they're leaving Monday for Machacamarca, Bolivia.
Oh.
And they're gonna face some new challenges. So we had to walk, you know, an hour up and down the mountain for our bridge sighting, so that was challenging. but they're going to be really high altitude in the winter. And so it might be snowing when they're there. Yeah, they're going to bring their coats. But I just, that travel team is so excited and I can't wait to go. And so I think the really cool thing about this is that we get to do it year in and year out, and it's always making a difference on Pitt State students. We can try to play a video. This was a video that I created, so you guys are kind of going to know most of this, but it hopefully will give a nice ending. We had a crowdfunding campaign to raise money for the bridge build, and...
Hi, my name is Grace Dingle, and I'm the president of Penn State Bridges to Prosperity, a student organization making a tangible impact in the world through the collaborative construction of pedestrian bridges in isolated areas. Estimated 1.4 billion people worldwide live on less than $1.25 a day. 75% of those people live in rural areas. For months during the year, these communities lose access to the world around them because of unsurpassable rivers. Children drown trying to get to school. Travelers never come home. Pedestrian bridges don't just create opportunities for people. They save lives. We at Penn State have been working diligently over the past 5 years to do just that. Each year we design a bridge, fully funded, and then send 8 students down during the month of May to build it with the local community. We're not just building a bridge. We're giving kids access to brighter futures. And we're reinstating trust with the local community and their municipality. This year we are headed to Bolivia, but we need your help. We need $10,000 to make this bridge a reality. Donating just $10 buys a portion of the rebar needed. $75 pays for the fencing, and a $350 donation will buy us one of our 5 gates, a key structural component of the bridge. Every dollar you give helps to improve the lives of an entire community. Penn State B2P has a motto, empowering today, inspiring tomorrow. Through your help, not only will we empower people with the skills they need to build a bridge, but we will inspire the next generation. Thank you.
Thank you.